Te invitamos ahora al ingeniero Daniel Trinchero con la conferencia Redes de Sensores y Dispositivos y sus aplicaciones. El ingeniero Daniel es director de XM Labs y docente del Departamento de Electrónica y Telecomunicaciones del Politécnico de Torino. Sus intereses como investigador abarcan redes inalámbricas, redes de sensores, Internet de las Cosas, agricultura inteligente, microondas, antenas, soluciones para reducir la brecha digital en las zonas rurales y remotas. Ha trabajado para instituciones académicas en Italia, Reino Unido, Estados Unidos, Francia y Qatar. Ha sido galardonado por el Banco Interamericano de Desarrollo y el Estado de Qatar por su trabajo en favor de la conectividad a Internet. Es miembro del Instituto de Ingenieros Eléctricos y Electrónicos. Es ingeniero electrónico con posgrado en gerencia de proyectos de telecomunicaciones y máster en administración de negocios. Tiene más de 17 años de experiencia en el sector TIC. Cuenta con una amplia trayectoria en dirección de proyectos e implementación de nuevos negocios y apropiación de nuevas tecnologías. Démosle la bienvenida al ingeniero Trinchero.
Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. My apologies for speaking English. Unfortunately, I could only speak either English or Italian, and I think that the best option now is to speak English. And my apologies also for my voice. Unfortunately, yesterday during my flight coming here, my voice dropped completely down. So I hope that especially the translators will be able to hear my tones that are quite small. So I was already introduced and the speech that we organized, I like this invitation, and I thank very much all the organizers for thinking to bring me in Bogota again. About 40 days after my first time in Bogota, I liked very much your country and the city, so it was really nice to come and visit you again. They asked me to speak about Internet of Things, and actually, as I saw all of the presenters before me, they spoke about Internet of Things. So my idea was to analyze four different projects that we have been working on in the last 5 years in the labs that I coordinate in my university. And these four projects, they demonstrate how the Internet of Things can be implemented even in very strong and complex places where theoretically no sensors, no communication are normally supposed to be present. So just to do a very, very extremely brief introduction, because all the previous presenters and probably all the next presenters will speak about what is the Internet of Things and what you do with the Internet of Things. Basically, Internet of Things is a conjunction of three things. You have instrumented things, it means that you have sensors, you have connectivity, and you have intelligence. These three aspects, they merge together and they bring to you the possibility to develop the smarter city, the smarter agriculture, and so on. But in order to have these three things together, you need to have the possibility to apply a sensor. You need to have the possibility to transmit, to communicate, and you need to apply intelligence in an efficient way. Intelligence costs money. It costs because intelligence it requires a lot of energy. When you move to the application of the Internet of Things to places where normally you are very remote, it is not guaranteed that the intelligence can be applied in an efficient way if you don't do your best in order to reduce the more that you can the computational capability, that means also the energy supply. So, instrumentation. There are many analyses and reports dealing with the incremental number of sensors and instruments that are populating the world. I'm not entering into this because before me it was more than well introduced. You have connections. connections almost everywhere. You have a very interesting plan here in Colombia to bring broadband, huge broadband, almost in all the country. But take into account that the things are also where the people are not. So it is not enough to bring connectivity to all the villages, even the smaller villages, because things sometimes are out of the villages. And then, obviously, you have the intelligence. The intelligence, that means microprocessors. Nowadays, a microprocessor costs about $1. If you buy 1,000 microprocessors, you spend half a dollar for each. So microprocessors are not a problem. What is very expensive is the powering capability. So basically, this is the paradigm, and this is the combination of the three effects, the end users, the services, the applications, and the infrastructure, things that were already analyzed very well by your minister, so I'm not going to enter into this as well. Now, when you speak about the smart city or a smart service, you may find in the internet or in the literature very different and very wide set of applications, and these applications may involve the city by itself in the sense of the management of the traffic, of the management also of the politics, but also from the side of the services and so on. So all these aspects, if you wanted to promote, for example, the eco-sustainability, if you wanted to promote and to increase the capability of doing commerce, are several and different and maybe coexisting visions of the smarter city. What I'm going to discuss and to present now is something that is completely different, and it is completely outside of the normal environment where you think that the human could be present. So the first project that I will introduce to you is one project that we have been working on for 4 years, and it is called WaterMall. The WaterMall was the development and the realization, put into practice and the validation of a device that uses wireless connectivity inside the ground, not only inside the ground and inside the water, in order to detect problems originated inside the pipelines that are used to transport the water when there are leakages. So basically to identify where a break is going to be present. This thing of the non-revenue water is a major problem worldwide. Apart from very few countries that are typically very rich, Singapore has the 4% of non-revenue water. But we have places around the world that they reach up to the 95% of lost water, the water that is not accounted, that is taken out of the original natural resources, and then it is not delivered or sold to the people. Among all the possible effects, obviously water can be stilled, you can have the possibility that you are not measuring and metering very well, but the most important thing is represented by losses. So you have this scheme that is showing. You see, you start with Singapore and Denmark, they are the most efficient countries. Still, they have 4 or 5%, which is physiological, of unaccounted water. But you see in Africa at which point you arrive, almost 100%. So there are systems that are normally very expensive, and they are not smart at all in order to identify the presence of the leakage. People that are using radars, ground radars, or geophones, and they hear the vibration in the ground. You need an expert, and it is not possible to bring these instruments that are very expensive and to transform into something that is independent, connected, intelligent, efficient. So what we have done, it was to combine two things. You see this device here in the pipe is considered to be something that is mounting just a very small hydrophone. An hydrophone is a sort of a microphone that is normally suitable to hear noises and voices within the water. It is normally used to hear the voices of the dolphins and the whales. We put it inside that bowl, an hydrophone, and then We thought that this ball could be transported by the water, obviously it has to be very small, could be transported by the water along the pipe, just hearing the voices. We have developed some intelligence on board, and we have, we have done a lot of work in order to make this intelligence very efficient in terms of the energetic cost. And basically, we ended up with a structure like this. You see that you have the hydrophone that is hearing the noises. Then you have the intelligence that is identifying those noises, those frequencies that can be connected and correlated to the presence of a leakage. It stores the information there. And while the device is moving around, when it is in the surroundings of a place where there is an antenna outside the pipe and outside the ground, you take the information and you identify exactly where it was located, the leakage. So this was the device, and this has been manufactured after 4 years. You may say that this is a simple device. Why does it take 4 years? Obviously, there was a lot of research on the background in order to make it efficient and properly working in the scenario that I told you. The nice thing is about the use of the spectrum, because this is an original way to use a radio transmission. You are using the spectrum within the ground. So I don't know this how it could be related to the activity, to the regulatory activity. Do I have to pay for a license to use a spectrum within the ground or not? This is something that I will leave for further discussions. Another thing we have been working on is this subject of the assisted agitator. This is very important because, can I ask for some water, please? Assisted agriculture is very important because especially in developing countries or anywhere you want to, yes, thank you. Thank you very much. Everywhere you want to help the farmer in order to make his production more efficient and also to give him suggestions and consultancy in order to reduce the most that you can the use of chemicals. That means that you are making a better production and also more organic. So in order to do this, there are some systems that are already connected to the internet. They think, for example, to use satellites or to use drones. But these things are expensive. And to bring a drone in a farm that is very far from Bogota, you need to have somebody that is capable to spend money for that. So the idea is to apply what it is normally done by an agronomic consultant that is moving around the field. It is normally leaving small traps or small devices, like, for example, the measurement of the humidity or the temperature. And then it is passing regularly among the fields in order to detect this information, to register, and to understand when is the time to do some activities or not. For example, to use chemical only when they are really needed. So this activity is something that can be transformed into a low-cost intelligent one. How? For example, by using a typical wireless sensor network, but the wireless sensor network, machine-to-machine networks, are normally conceived in order to transport a very limited amount of data. And they do not require a huge amount of spectrum because you have just to transmit a few numbers. So how do you combine the possibility to transmit images taken by a webcam over a wireless sensor network that is not conceived to transmit high definition data? This is possible because when you work in agriculture, for sure, if you take an image of a plant, the plant is not going to change their status in a couple of hours. So you take one picture every hour or every 2 hours, and you transport over the system even with longer times in order to arrive to the destination. So this was the idea. The idea was applied in a field. You see the deployment of a lot of sensors, each of them with a camera. So the idea is to have internet somewhere, to have a base station that is a gateway to the internet, to have some nodes that are managing sensors and cameras, and each node is directly connected to the base station, if it is close to the base station. If not, there will be a mesh network that is conceived to pass by neighboring nodes, and if a set of nodes is too far, then there is a repeater that is connected to the base station, and some nodes will be connected before to the repeater and then to the base station. So this is a typical scheme that can be used in order to report the information even on a very large space and huge distances. This is the solution that we have implemented for the gateway, the base station. You see that here there is just a microcomputer, a Raspberry, and this is the sensor node, which is represented here. This is the access point that is communicating and taking the information from all the nodes that are deployed in the surroundings. This is the node. You see the dimension. The dimension of the node is very small. There is the camera. This camera, even if it costs no more than $20, this camera is the same that is mounted on the iPhone. So it is capable to take the same pictures of the iPhone. And this is an antenna that was designed, patented and designed in our labs, and it is particularly efficient in to transmit the images even if it is in the surrounding of the leaves, so in non in line of sight with the gateway. So the idea is that you have a deployment like this, and you have one node that at least is capable to reach one of the four neighboring ones. And by just analyzing the performance of the system, we can say that the distance between two consecutive nodes can reach up to 750 meters. That means that we can have a repeater every 3,000 hectares. That means that it is not one gateway to the internet every 3,000 hectares. It means that one repeater with these nodes can be located in a huge area of 3,000 hectares. The total system that is capable to monitor the area with these characteristics, taking images, taking data about the temperature, humidity, and also the humidity and the water in the terrain, it is something that costs for 30 nodes and for one gateway, it is something that totally it costs altogether less than 500 euros. So this is one implementation in a vineyard in Italy. And the other thing is that when you try to do something that is very efficient from an energetic point of view, another thing that you obtain is also to have it very small. In fact, you don't, I mean, maybe you can see it, but it is quite difficult if you don't know from before. So the device is there, and it is located over there. No external antennas, nothing. You see that it is capable to transmit, because the thing is that we use a bandwidth that is very small. We don't use more than 30 kilohertz bandwidth. That means that unfortunately the image is transmitted over 2 or 3 minutes, but the capability is to have a noise threshold so low that it is possible to reach the device even if it is not in line of sight. I have prepared a video that was taken by one of these sensors during the work that has been done last year. I ask the guy over there just if they can run it. There is no audio, obviously the grape is, no, forget about the audio. It is, I mean, for me, this is just a video. But the agronomist I was working with, they told me that it is important and very important, because thanks to this they were able to identify exactly which are the conditions where to exactly use the chemicals and to reduce a lot the chemicals. Okay, maybe I will see show you later. Let me go further. Ah no, they took the control. Okay. Okay. So you see, this was happening in the middle of August. Normally we have a Wehrmesting in my part of Italy, that is during October. And you see that in the middle of August, these pictures are just representing the changing colors of the grapes that are getting darker and darker, and they get the color that will be the one that is the final one. Now, it is just a representation. It doesn't want to be more than a representation, but the nice thing is that thanks to these pictures, the agronomist was clearly able to identify which was the exact time to do some external activity within the fields. You see the changing color that is coming more and more evident. Even if these images were taken with a very simple device and the battery that was used to take all these images and to transmit the images over each single node, it was less, I mean, it was lasting a normal battery. It was lasting for more than, you see now the color is completely mature, the battery was lasting for almost half of the season. Okay, so there is also an economical perspective on this side. It is not just a matter to produce something that is more efficient and more organic. We have demonstrated that, for example, for the case of the vineyards, we can produce a saving of about 625 euro per hectare, meaning that we reduce more than one half the cost that is typically paid by a farmer when he's using chemicals in an uncontrolled way. Another thing that I will show you very fast now is this other system that we had developed in order to measure the humidity in the terrain. And the nice thing, again, is that is using wireless transmission, but not to transmit information. It uses wireless transmission in order to identify which is the change in status of the soil because of the presence of the water. It is quite a simple thing to do. It doesn't require a big excavation because the sticks are very thin, and it is very efficient and very precise in measuring the humidity in the terrain. You can imagine how useful can be a system like this, because it will give you exactly the timing when you have to water the fields with absolute precision. The same system, okay, probably doesn't apply very much to your country, but the same system was used to detect the presence of the water in the snow over the Alps, and this was again connected to a system of wireless sensor network to predict the avalanches. The last case that I want to show you is this one. It's a project that is called El Connect that was using wireless sensor networks that were wired by all the people living alone in the houses, and the idea is that you have a very simple and very immediate and very low cost system that is suitable to detect the presence of a person and if the person is moving around. Sorry for this written in Italian, but actually it was the printout of the software that we were using in order to assist the old people, and believe me, it was not possible to have a software written in English. So this is another example of application that worked very well. All these systems and applications have a common denominator. They cost aside from the cost of the research, obviously, but the cost for the implementation and the put into practice is very small, especially the energy cost. And this is it. Thank you, and sorry for the non-perfect voice.